Quest presents an unabridged recording of The Tenant by Angela Lester, narrated by Laura Brydon. Prologue. Through a gap in the curtains, she can see the blue light flashing. Darkness is gathering outside. A car door is slammed shut and someone opens the screeching gate. When she hears the doorbell, she hauls herself up. She ignores the second ring. On her way to the stairs, she opens the living room door. The half-light makes everything look black and white, like in an old photo, she thinks. She hasn't been in there for weeks. Everything still seems the same, as if frozen in time. The overflowing ashtray on the table, the pile of magazines on the floor. Her glance falls on the dark stain on the carpet, the bloody handprints on the wall. A movement in the shadows makes her jump. Something scurries over the carpet. The house is infested with mice. A man is shouting outside, but she slowly makes her way upstairs. The sickly sweet stench is far stronger here. Now people can smell it outside. The next door neighbour asked about it the other day. She kicks away the towel rolled against the bottom of the door. Holding her breath, she presses the handle down. The window is open, the curtain billowing in the cold breeze. The fair hair looks like a halo against the darker pillow. The colour has drained from her face. The white lips are cracked. A skinny arm dangles over the edge. She touches it lightly. It feels ice cold. There is a crash downstairs as they break the front door open. She walks over to the bedside cabinet where the old alarm clock is still ticking. Next to it is the white plastic bottle with the tranquilizers. She opens the screw top, pops a few pills into her mouth, and forces them down. Chapter 1. The terraced houses on Chapel Road were all similar, with bay windows on the ground floor and two rooms above. Some looked like student houses to me, with piles of bin bags in the front gardens, while others appeared more respectable with doors and window frames newly painted. Maybe the road had been more upmarket once. I was in a cul-de-sac leading to a railway bridge. Number 112 was right at the end, a pebble-dashed house with dirty lace curtains downstairs. It looked shabby and uncared for. The small front garden was concreted over, but weeds were growing through the cracks and the white paintwork around the windows had turned grey with dirt and age. The low stone wall at the front was bowed with some bricks missing. I hesitated a moment, then walked up to the front door. I could hear a hoover inside. I rang the bell. When nothing happened, I rang again and then knocked. Suddenly the door was opened.
Hi!
A plump, middle-aged woman looked out. She wore a loose, checkered shirt over ill-fitting jeans. Her eyes were a light hazel brown behind square metal glasses.
I'm here for the room. I'm expecting someone in an hour.
But that would be me. We talked on the phone. I had immediately recognised her high-pitched voice, yet it didn't match her matronly appearance.
Are you Kate, the music student?
Yes, sorry I'm so early. The enrolment was over in no time and there was no point in hanging about. I trailed off, feeling a bit uncomfortable under her unwavering gaze.
I could come later if that's more convenient. No need, I'm Amy.
Her podgy hand touched my shoulder.
Sorry for the inconvenience, I haven't finished the cleaning yet.
I followed her into a dimly lit hall. The air was damp and musty, a strange smell mingling with the sharp odour of cleaning fluids. I nearly slipped on the wet tiled floor.
The bedrooms are upstairs and we can share the rest, she said,
leading me through a glass-panelled door into a stuffy room. There was an electric fire, a sofa and a couple of upholstered chairs facing a silver television set that could have easily been 25 years old. A tall, glass-fronted cabinet contained dusty plates and glasses. Here, too, was the musty smell.
I noticed that the wallpaper and imitation wood grain was peeling at the window. "It's a bit damp," I said. "I'm going to renovate downstairs." She held my gaze. "There was no time for that before. My mother was not well. I looked after her." She sighed. "She was poorly for years. I haven't changed anything since she passed." "Of course, I understand," I said, quickly doing the maths. She looked middle-aged. There was a lot of grey in her frizzy hair. Her face was pale, the skin oily without any noticeable lines. Her mother could have been in her 70s or 80s for all I knew. No wonder she hadn't decorated yet. It must have been a difficult time for her. She was probably still grieving.
"My mother loved this room. She used to spend a lot of time in here."
"There are some nice old pieces." I glanced at the ugly glass-fronted cabinet. "The house must mean a lot to you."
"Yes, I've always lived here."
Without another word, she turned around. I followed her into the middle room. She switched on the ceiling light. The small room had only one window to the back and was cluttered with a random assortment of chairs, a rectangular table, and dusty shelves. All I saw was the upright piano. It stood against the back wall, a beautiful instrument with intricate designs and candle holders on either side.
"You can use it if you like," she said. "It would be lovely to hear someone play on it. Didn't you say on the phone you were a pianist?"
"It's beautiful." I stroked my fingers across the dark, polished wood. "Is it tuned?"
"No idea."
She gave me a sideways glance.
"How come you're starting college at your age?"
"I suppose it was something I always wanted to do."
"What did you do before?"
"I was a librarian in Carlisle."
"I suppose you must be good at playing."
"Not as good as I would like to be," I swallowed. "But it's important to me, and I need a new start."
"Running away from something, are you?"
"I wouldn't say that." I could feel the blood rushing to my face. Seeing my embarrassment, she chuckled.
"How silly of me. I was only joking. It's good to follow your dreams. Come on."
She gently pulled my arm.
"I'll show you the rest of the house."
The door to the kitchen was open. She'd been scrubbing the floor. It smelled of bleach. Faux marble laminated kitchen units ran along two sides with a big metal sink in the corner. There were cobwebs near the window and at the corners of the ceiling. But I had been too early and could hardly blame her for not finishing the cleaning. I followed her up the stairs to the landing, walking past what seemed to be her room. She quickly closed the door, but not before I had caught a glimpse of the chaos inside. Papers and books strewn all over the floor. The bathroom was next to it and another bedroom a bit further down on the other side.
"I've just been sorting out some stuff."
She shoved a full bin bag out of the way.
"I thought I'd get rid of the pictures for you."
It was a decent-sized room overlooking the back garden. Along the left-hand wall was a pink quilted bed with a matching pink upholstered headboard. Behind the door was a wooden wardrobe. On the other side near the window stood an old-style bureau dresser. The red velvet curtains were half-drawn, leaving the room in a dusky light. It struck me that this would have been her mother's room. There were still marks on the wall, hooks and nails where pictures had hung.
"I would probably paint the walls," I said hesitantly, "if that's okay with you." "Of course, you can do what you like with it."
I went to the window, my footsteps noisy on the wooden floor, and I wondered if there had been a carpet before. It was a small garden, completely overgrown with trees and shrubs. There was a broken concrete garden cherub half covered by weeds. I could hear the low rumble of a train going past.
"You hardly hear it when you close the window," she said. "Only a few freight trains go past at night."
"It could be a nice little garden," I said politely. "Do you sometimes get the sun out there?" I turned around. She was still standing in the doorway as if reluctant to come inside.
"I don't have a lot of time for lying in the sun. Of course. You said you were busy. What is it you do? I asked, remembering the papers in her room.
I'm writing a book.
How interesting. What is it about?
The past.
She hesitated, opened her mouth as if to say more, and then closed it again.
That's why I'm renting out the room. I haven't got much time for anything else. It's a lot of work if you take it seriously.
I bet. I wish I could write.
Really?
Her eyes held mine.
When are you moving in? Will you drive up to get your stuff?
There was something hasty in her tone of voice, an urgency that made me turn away and look out of the window again. It would be nice to have a garden, I said, to win time. Have you had other people interested? My glance fell on an apple tree among the shrubs. It had some sort of fungal disease, the branches covered with mould. It had produced some apples, but they were all deformed with brown, unhealthy-looking spots. I shivered in spite of my coat.
No, no one so far, but someone else is coming later on.
I'll let you know.
Could you move in straight away?
Yes, I've got the necessary things with me. My suitcase is still in the hotel. The other stuff can stay in storage in Carlisle.
It would save you paying for another night.
There was that urgent edge to her voice again. That would be good, I agreed, following her downstairs. I have to watch it now that I'm not working. Life's expensive with no money coming in.
You won't get it cheaper anywhere else.
She was right. I'd had a look around the hall of residence. The rooms were as tiny as prison cells, nothing but four walls, a bed, a desk, and a wardrobe. It was the only place I could afford, but I hadn't liked it a bit. I also knew that I'd feel out of place, so much older than everyone else.
Don't leave it too long, she said. Someone is coming at 4 o'clock. I have to know by then.
I'll give you a ring. I shook her hand. It's a nice house and the piano is a real plus. Thanks for showing me round.
No problem. Let me know what you've decided,
she said and closed the door behind me as I left. The drizzle that had been coming down all day was beginning to turn into heavy rain. The sky was dark with clouds, a leaden, unbroken grey obscuring the sun. I made my way over to Albany Road and took shelter in coffee number one. A waitress brought the tea in a white china pot. I took a sip, trying to calm my unease. Running away from something. It hadn't been far from the truth. An image of Jeremy surged through my mind, a look of anger on his face. Our last chat had been in a cafe like this. I shook my head to shoo away the thought. The brooding only made it worse. It would do me good to have some company, I reasoned, turning my attention back to Amy and the house. She was in her late 40s, I guessed, about 10 years older than me. She had seemed quite keen. Perhaps she was lonely. Her mother had probably died in that room. But so what? Countless people must have lived and died in these old houses. I thought of the ceiling rose in the living room. There was definitely potential. The rooms just needed painting and even the garden could be trimmed and tidied up. The position was ideal, so near the college, and it was cheap. My financial situation was beginning to worry me a bit. I didn't have an income now, and the course fees had all but exhausted my savings. At 3:30, I was standing in front of the house again. I had fetched my suitcase from the hotel and stopped to get some groceries and wine on my way back. I rang the bell. Without the whining of the Hoover, the old-fashioned chime was clearly audible. It took a few moments until she came to the door.
Oh, hi,
she said, as if surprised to see me again. She glanced at my suitcase.
I was beginning to get a bit worried. You didn't phone.
But here I am, ready to move in, I said cheerfully. If that's still okay with you, is the other person from the agency still coming?
I cancelled the viewing, she said. Of course, the room is still yours if you want it. You know where it is, so I'll let you get on with it. I haven't finished the hoovering yet.
I've bought a bottle of wine and cheese, I handed her the shopping bag. Maybe we can have a glass later on. She peered into the bag.
Thanks, but you shouldn't have.
What time shall I come down?
Any time you like, whenever it suits you.
I could hear the TV in the living room, some sort of game show she was watching. She was probably having a break from her cleaning. I stepped over the Hoover and carried my heavy suitcase upstairs. I opened it on the bed and got out my new paisley-printed scarf. I had wondered what would be suitable for wearing at college, and on my last day in Carlisle, I'd gone into town and bought some bits and pieces in Gap. A leather bag, a few new blouses, and a beautiful boho-style scarf. I glanced across the room. As before, my attention was drawn to the hooks and discoloured patches on the wall. The wallpaper, with its pattern of lilac roses, looked dark and gloomy in the fading light. Perhaps I should hang some photos. I had to make the best of my new place. Realising that I was still clutching the scarf, I unclenched my fingers and dropped it on the bed. This was a new start, and I had to leave the past behind. It really didn't matter anymore. I changed out of my damp slacks into a more comfortable pair of jeans and unpacked quickly, putting dresses on hangers, tossing the underwear onto the top shelf of the wardrobe, stacking my books on the table. I would need some sort of carpet to dampen the sound. The echo of my footsteps was beginning to unsettle me. I crossed the room and fully opened the curtains, but the afternoon light that seeped through the dirty windows was murky and grey. It was still raining. Raindrops splattered across the window, blurring my view. I thought of Amy's relieved expression and wondered if I should have given her a ring. She had cancelled the other viewing because of me. I stood for a long while looking out. The future was uncertain. No wonder I felt a bit edgy. For once, I had changed the course of my life and made a decision. I had to make a success of it. There was nothing much left for me in Carlisle. It would be impossible to go back to the library now and work with Jeremy again. Not after what had happened in the summer. I caught sight of the bulging bin bag outside. It was the one I had seen on the landing earlier on. A wooden picture frame was sticking out.
I was wondering about the rent.
Amy startled me out of my thoughts. I swung around, surprised to see her in the doorway. I hadn't heard her coming in.
I'm a bit out of pocket with all the bills I had to pay, she said in her high-pitched voice. I'm really sorry, but I was wondering if you could give me the money now.
No problem. I picked up my purse. Luckily, I had been to the bank.
Thanks.
She took the £300.
Have you eaten? I'm starving. The miserable weather always makes me hungry. I could order a pizza for us.
Her eyes darted around the room as if to see whether I had made any changes. Yes, fine. I wondered about the bread and cheese, but didn't want to ask. Shortly after, I heard the delivery man at the door. When I made my way downstairs, I found her in the living room, the pizza still in its box, two plates and wine glasses on the low wooden table in front of her. It was warmer than upstairs. She had turned the fire on, an old-fashioned gas fireplace with artificial coals and bright blue flames. She opened the box, cut the pizza, and handed over the plate with my half. Pepperoni and tomato. Not exactly what I would have chosen. I poured the wine. The glasses were beautiful with pale green bowls and amber stems. Lovely glasses. Were they your mother's?
Yes, I think so, she shrugged. But she never drank out of them. She didn't care much for pretty things.
We started eating. It can't have been easy for you, I said, interrupting the awkward silence. Looking after her.
No, it wasn't.
She licked her fingers, smeared with tomato sauce.
She was in a bad way.
I'm sorry. I took a sip of my wine. What was wrong with her?
She had a problem, she said, gazing at me. She drank herself to death. It started when I was still at school. She wrote me sick notes when she needed me at home.
She'd work for a couple of weeks and everything would seem okay until something happened again and bang, she'd buy a bottle of gin and go on another bender. The sober periods grew shorter every time. In the end, she gave up working altogether. Over the last few years, she didn't even get out of bed anymore.
Lost for words, I took another bite of my greasy pizza. I had to force myself to eat. Thick slices of pepperoni sat in pools of melted cheese. She refilled our glasses.
It must have been so terrible for you, I said eventually. Why are you whispering? She chuckled. Don't worry, she's gone. She won't come back.
Of course not. I managed a smile.
What about you? She asked. I'm sure you had a better time. Your parents must have been proud of your piano playing. Did they expect you to become a celebrated pianist?
I don't think so. The word celebrated made me laugh. My dad wanted me to have a secure career. I told her about my father and the tobacconist's shop he had managed.
And what about your mother? She asked. I bet she wanted you to go to music college.
Oh, not at all. Playing the organ in church would have been more up her street. She thought that artists and musicians were expendable. Or maybe she thought I wouldn't get in anyway.
And then you did what they expected. How boring is that?
She shook her head in mock dismay. Yes, I laughed. I suppose that's what I'm like. But I didn't mind being a librarian. It wasn't a bad decision. I quite liked my job.
But what about your playing? I hope you didn't give it up.
She looked disappointed. Not really, though I stopped practicing for quite some time when my sister died. It was a sad time, but in the end I took it up again. I was never good enough to be a concert pianist, but I still could be a teacher. I just have to do it now, before I'm too old. I leaned back, relaxing into the sofa. I had never talked about it like that before. Amy's directness was strangely liberating. She wore her frizzy hair tied back. Her face was a bit flushed from the wine and her light eyes seemed to have more colour and life. She looked almost pretty in the warm glow of the standard lamp. I remembered how I had worried about making friends, how shy and awkward I always felt in social situations, and yet here I was, drinking wine with Amy, opening up to her and talking about the past.
"Here's to the future," I said, raising my glass. "I'll help you with the decorating. It'll be fun. The house will scrub up nicely, you'll see. We're going to make a good team."
Chapter 2. Dr. Jack Turner was my personal tutor. He was in his mid-40s, tall with greying hair and square Ray-Ban glasses. I had met him during Freshers' Week. With my sweaty hands clasped tightly, I had sat in the armchair opposite his desk as he talked me through the assignments. There were essays to be delivered on time, oral and written exams, and of course performances, including a big concert at the end of term. Sensing my unease, he looked at me with concern and asked if there was anything bothering me. I explained to him that it wasn't the academic work, but the performing I was a bit worried about. I told him that I had never played for a bigger audience before and that I wasn't very confident.
"It'll get better with experience," Dr. Turner had said, smiling. "You'll get used to it soon enough. I saw in the entry audition that you can play."
There was no hint of condescension in his voice, but I could tell that he was just being kind. Performing in front of the lecturers had been nerve-wracking. I had just about struggled through the repertoire of grade 8 pieces with stiff, cold hands. Glancing around the foyer now, I could still not quite believe that I was actually part of this. It felt as if they had turned a blind eye. I was determined to prove that Dr. Turner's kindness had not been wasted on me, that I was worthy of the chance he'd given me. The students stood around in groups, chatting.
I recognised faces from the introductory tutorial, but no one seemed to notice me as I made my way to the stairs. Term was starting slowly. There was only one lecture today, an introduction to music history focused on the 18th century. I was about 15 minutes early, and the big lecture theatre on the second floor was still empty. I sat down in the last but one row of wooden seats, got out my pen and paper, and had another look at my lecture timetable. From the corner of my eye, I saw Dr. Turner enter, carrying a big pile of books. He left them on the desk at the front. "Hello there," he said, stopping on his way out. "I was wondering if I could ask you a favour. The choir needs an accompanist. We're doing Mozart's Requiem. Our pianist is on leave until December." He paused a moment, his intelligent eyes expectantly fixed on me. "Let me know. You'd be really helping us out, and it would be a good opportunity for you to get used to it." And then he hurried out at the door, maybe to fetch more books. A few students were coming in through the side door, amongst them Gemma Adams, a chubby girl with fuzzy blonde hair and butterfly glasses. I knew her from the introductory meeting. Gemma was from Carlisle, like me. We'd even been to the same school, a chaotic comprehensive on the outskirts of town. She, of course, 20 years later than me.
"Hi," she said, sitting down next to me. "Were we supposed to read something to prepare for this?"
She glanced at the pile of books on Dr. Turner's desk and let out a sigh.
"I haven't even looked at the reading list yet."
More and more students were coming in now and the theatre was filling up. A red-haired girl in front of us turned around.
"Oh, we shouldn't have had that last drink," she said to Gemma with an exaggerated grimace. "Or maybe I should have stayed in bed. Nothing happens in the first week anyway. Oh, my head is killing me."
"Your own fault, you wanted it," Gemma laughed. "You still owe me the money for the taxi."
Dr. Turner came back in and closed the door. The noisy chatter gradually died down as he went to the front and set up his PowerPoint.
"Good morning, everyone," he began. "Who can tell me about the 18th century? Who were the most influential composers?"
A girl in my row raised her hand. The lecture went by in a daze. I still could not believe he had asked me to do the accompaniment for his choir. He obviously had faith in me, certainly more than I had in myself. I made a lot of longhand notes, scribbling into my new notebook, only now and then looking up at the PowerPoint so as to avoid his gaze. It had been a kind offer, but I needed more time to think about it. It would be best to leave straight afterwards before he had the chance to mention it again. Towards the end, he talked about the coursework we had to hand in by the end of November. The essay had to explore how Baroque music bridged the gap between Renaissance and early music. Everything was done electronically these days, of course, and we could log into a website for all the information we needed.
"Not much time with everything else we've got to do," Gemma moaned as we got up.
"You'd have more time if you stopped going on about it," the red-haired girl had caught up with us at the door.
"Yeah, right,"
Gemma pulled a face.
"You can't copy stuff from the internet here. They'll find out straight away."
They obviously knew each other well. Everyone was leaving now. I briefly lost sight of them in the crowd, but they waited for me in the foyer.
"Coming along?" Gemma asked. "We're having something to eat in Aberdare Hall."
Not today.
Looking up, I saw Dr. Turner on the stairs.
"I've got to be somewhere."
They both stared at me, startled by the note of panic in my voice.
"Maybe another time."
I quickly walked off through a swing door and then into the library. A few students were sitting at the tables, reading and writing. For a moment, I just stood there, taking it in, fingers tapping at a keyboard, the whir of a copy machine, the hushed voices. The windowless room with its rows of bookshelves and humming light was so much like the library in Carlisle. I inhaled the familiar smell. It would be so much easier, so much safer to order books, conduct searches,
do what I had done successfully for all those years. I found Mozart's Requiem at the back among the other vocal and orchestral scores, and the librarian, a friendly middle-aged woman, checked it out. The corridor was empty, but there was music coming from most of the practice rooms. I wondered if I should find an empty room to have a go at the Mozart, but then decided to go home. I needed time and space to think. The sun had come out, and it was noticeably warmer now as I stepped out of the red brick building. There were students sitting on the grass, chatting in little groups of threes and fours or eating their sandwiches. I kept my gaze straight ahead as I walked past, hoping that Gemma and her red-haired friend weren't amongst them. Amy had given me a spare set of keys and I let myself in through the front door. The house felt empty. The breakfast dishes were still on the kitchen table, the heating was off, and the kitchen had a depressing feel. As in the other rooms, the wallpaper was stained with damp. The windows were so dirty they didn't let in much light. I switched on the ceiling lamp. The naked 40-watt bulb only added to the cheerlessness. There was not much in the fridge, just a bottle of Diet Coke and the piece of cheddar I had bought the other day, still unopened in its plastic wrapping. Not quite sure what to do, I put the kettle on and, waiting for it to boil, opened the door to the garden to let in some air. My glance fell on the bin bag outside. It was the stuff Amy had discarded from her mother's room. The bag was undone. I took out the wooden picture frame and put it right side up. It was the portrait of a woman. There were the bookshelves, and I straight away recognised the piano. The photo had been taken some time ago when the house had been in a much better state. She was sitting at the piano, her hands on the keys. She was beautiful in a pre-Raphaelite way, the fair complexion, her long red hair, those slender pale hands. There was a faraway expression in her eyes. Could that be Amy's mother, I wondered? Who else would it be? She looked nothing like Amy, and she certainly didn't look sick. There were no telltale signs of her drinking. Had the picture been in her room? How depressing for her to look at her younger, more beautiful self when she'd been in such a terrible state later on. There was other stuff, a portrait of the young Beethoven with short dark hair and piercing dark eyes, and, digging deeper, I found a couple of porcelain cherubs and vases. What else had Amy thrown out? There had been no clothes in the wardrobe, no personal things at all. I shivered in my thin jumper. The sky had clouded over and it looked like rain. A sudden gust of wind made the apple tree rustle and rattled the open windows upstairs. I looked up and, for a fleeting moment, thought I saw a movement up there in my room. I kept on looking, but there was nothing, just the curtains billowing slightly in the breeze. I laughed at myself. No one was watching me. I had probably just imagined it because I felt guilty for snooping around. I quickly put the pictures back into the bag, taking care to leave them in the position they had been before. The water had boiled. I made myself a cup of tea and took it with me into the middle room. The tall piano with its polished wood glowed darkly. I opened the stool and saw some sheet music inside. I glanced through it, mainly Beethoven, Schubert, and Bach. Sitting down, I tried a few chords. The sound was amazing. I blew against my cold hands and ran my fingers through the first movement of a Schubert impromptu. I hadn't been playing very long when I sensed again that someone was watching. Looking up, I saw Amy in the open doorway, peering in from the dark hall. "I didn't want to interrupt," she said. "I thought I was on my own." I closed the lid. "I was in my room. I found the scores in the piano stool. Were they your mother's? It's quite demanding stuff. I don't know anything about it." For a moment, her face grew distant and sullen. "Maybe she played it when she was younger. I told you that she stayed in bed most days." She brightened a bit then as she came nearer and glanced at the score. "It sounded really good. You told me everyone else was better than you. I thought you were just a beginner. I didn't say that. I just...
My voice was shaky, and to my embarrassment, I felt a prickle behind my eyes. The tension I had felt all day suddenly got on top of me. I swiveled round on the piano stool so that she wouldn't see.
I just don't like performing.
Why is that?
I don't know. It's stressful.
I got up, wiping away the tears. I think about the mistakes I can make and then everything goes wrong. One arm around my shoulders, she led me into the living room like a mother would lead a sick child. She sat next to me on the sofa.
What's brought this on? She asked.
I told her about the choir.
But you don't have to do it.
She gave me a paper handkerchief.
Why don't you tell him to ask someone else? It's not fair to put so much pressure on you.
No, I think he wants to help me.
I blew my nose.
I told him that I'm not comfortable with performing. He wants me to get used to it and lose my fear.
But you don't really need to perform a lot, right?
She frowned.
You only want to be a teacher. Why all that extra stress with the choir? You'll just have to get through the stuff for your degree.
I took a deep breath. But I don't want to let him down. He's been so kind to me. I trailed off.
He's been so kind to me, she chuckled. It almost sounds as if you fancy him.
He's a very nice man, I said stiffly.
For a moment, I felt like walking out on her in that grimy old house. If only I had not given her the rent. My glance fell on the unsightly damp patch beneath the window.
Why don't we make a start on the decorating?
Her tone had softened.
Sorry for winding you up, I was only joking. The house is really getting me down. Let's go and buy the paint.
Why not? I nodded.
She was right, of course. We really had to make a start. The wallpaper in my bedroom gave me the creeps. It was the pattern Amy's mother had looked at for all those years from her bed. I had been awake for hours in the night, lying on my side, my eyes fixed on the opposite wall, just able to make out those eerie roses in the dark, sensing her spirit was still in there. No wonder I was feeling a bit edgy.
And I'm starving, Amy said, getting up. Maybe we can get something to eat on Newport Road. You're hungry too?
What sort of food are you thinking of? I said. Still a bit miffed.
I'll have to get some money from the machine.
Oh, nothing too expensive.
She rubbed her chubby hands.
So, what's the plan? Are we going? I could do with a burger. I know where we can get the paint.
Half an hour later, we were at the McDonald's on Newport Road. We sat down at a table near the window with our tray of chicken burgers and chips. The table was dirty with crumbs and ketchup smudges. A girl in uniform who'd been mopping the floor came over and wiped it clean. There was a group of teenagers at the table next to us, shouting and laughing.
We should get in some food, I said over the noise. We need to eat something healthy, like vegetables and fruit.
Maybe we can buy a microwave.
She grabbed a couple of chips and popped them into her mouth. Did you cook for your mother?
She didn't care much for food. She had a lot of stomach trouble. She wouldn't have eaten vegetables anyway. Sometimes she didn't eat for days.
But it can't have always been like that.
Amy didn't answer, and for a minute or two we focused on our food. She was eating fast. Her face was glistening with perspiration. When had she had her last proper meal, I wondered. There never seemed anything else but crisps in the house. She was wearing the blue and white checkered shirt again, which looked a bit grey at the sleeves. It struck me that she probably didn't have the money to buy herself new clothes.
When did your mum buy the house?
I don't know, she answered, chewing. Before I was born.
That would have been in the 60s?
Yes, around that time, she said vaguely.
She looked across to the teenagers.
Kids! Why do they always make so much noise?
It must have been a nice house back then.
Why?
I was wondering about your mum. When did she start drinking so much?
When I was little. What does it matter?
She wiped her mouth with a paper napkin.
The house has always been a dump. Anyway, it's all in the book I'm writing.
Are you writing about your childhood?
Yes.
She sat back, her big arms folded.
I've written the first chapter. There's a lot about my mother. I don't want to talk about it now. It only gets me down. Maybe you can read it when it's finished.
Afterwards, we went to B&Q a little further down the road. We asked for directions and a thin young man in a suit came with us down the aisle and showed us around. We chose the paints he recommended, a light magnolia for my room, blue for the bathroom and pale yellow for downstairs. Adding paintbrushes, rollers and scrapers, we rolled our rattling trolley to the till. When we came home, it was already getting dark. I felt like starting straight away. I filled a bucket in the bathroom and with a brush started wetting the wallpaper near the door. It was the section you saw from the bed. The soft, wet paper was quite easy to scrape off. It was all about being in charge and changing the things that held me back. Seeing the shreds of that horrible paper come off in big pieces was a relief. The darkness in me was beginning to lift. With every stripped sheet, I was feeling more energised and positive. A fleeting image of Jeremy bubbled up. Taking off the sodden old paper felt like ripping those memories out of my mind. The lonely evenings waiting for him.
"You're a liability," he'd said in the cafe. "You're crazy, phoning me up in the middle of the night. And now you can't even remember shouting at me. You should see someone about your drinking."
All the time I could hear Amy downstairs. The TV was blaring again. There were voices and music. After a couple of hours, my fingers and knuckles began to hurt from the peeling. It was getting late. The top layer was gone, but there was another layer underneath, an egg white underpaper, which was softer and much more tricky to scrape off. When I went downstairs to fetch a couple of bin bags, I found Amy in the front room, watching Casualty. "It took longer than I thought. I'll do the painting tomorrow," I said.
"I'm surprised you can see in that dim light," she chuckled. "You must be determined."
It was nearly 11 when the final strip came off. I called Amy to show her what I had done.
"Wow," she said, stepping into the soggy mess. "I'm so glad you got rid of it. You really deserve a reward."
She reached into the pocket of her jeans and got out a packet of pills.
"I had them in my drawer. They're still okay. Diazepam," she smiled. "It's just what you need. My GP prescribed them when I couldn't sleep after my mother had died. It really got to me. It says in the instruction leaflet that they're also for anxiety. They'll calm you down a bit and help with the performing. You can take them when you have to play for that choir."
"I'm not sure." I reluctantly turned the red-white packet in my hand. "I can't just take tablets that are meant for someone else."
"Don't worry. You can check them on the internet. Lots of people take them. They're not dangerous."
She cocked her head to one side.
"Unless you take them all at once," she chuckled. "No, honestly, they really make a difference. It's up to you, anyway."
She glanced at my bare walls.
"Now you've made a start, I suppose I'll have to do downstairs as well."
But she didn't, of course. She soon lost interest, and as I was busy and not prepared to do all the work on my own, the room remained unchanged for all those months I lived with her. At first, we joked about it, but when things became more difficult, it was never mentioned again.
Chapter 3. The following week was busy. I went to more classes, met new lecturers and saw the same students again. Gemma Adams was in most of my courses and we sometimes had coffee or lunch together in Aberdare Hall. The sister of her red-haired friend had been to the music department before. Gemma knew a lot of gossip through her.
It was going through a messy divorce a couple of years ago, she said when she was sitting next to me in history again. Dr. Turner had turned his back to us as he was setting up his PowerPoint. He was suspended for months. Why? What happened? I whispered back. Affairs, she answered, her eyes shining. Couldn't keep it in his pants. He had a thing for a first-year student. Or was it sexual harassment? I can't remember. Anyway, it was the reason he got divorced. His wife had probably had enough.
She dramatically rolled her eyes.
Sandra's sister said he nearly lost his job because of it.
Throughout the 50-minute lecture, I kept surreptitiously glancing at him, only half concentrating on his slideshow of 18th-century instruments. With his open face and jovial manner, he seemed like a family man to me rather than someone who would go off the rails and cheat on his wife. Was his easy charm just a front, a part of his public persona, I wondered. The expression of his mouth, the way it now and then curled into an ironic smile when an answer was not to his liking, suggested that there was a different side to him. He appeared to be popular with the students. I had heard that he had a daughter who was still at school. Someone else had told me that he had composed several pieces and was quite well known in the Welsh music scene. He had apparently been friends with Simon Rattle in Birmingham, where he earned his first degree. When the lecture was over, I made my way downstairs to find an empty practice room. I had still not made up my mind about the choir, quietly hoping that he would ask someone else. But I had started practicing the Mozart anyway. Playing relaxed me between classes. I liked the anonymity of the practice rooms, the musty smell, and that it was always half dark in there because of the narrow windows. I had just started playing when someone knocked. I expected a student and was a bit startled to see Dr. Turner's face in the door.
I thought it might be you, he said. Sorry to interrupt your Mozart, but could you come to my office later to talk about the accompaniment? I need to give you the rehearsal schedule.
He gave me a broad, pleasant smile.
Sounds excellent, he said. Keep up the good work.
My heart was beating faster as I carried on playing. How could I get out of it now? Eventually, I made my way upstairs.
Come on in,
he said, opening the door. He was talking on his mobile.
I won't be long,
he mouthed in my direction and motioned me to sit down.
The train gets in at 6. He said in a low voice. I'll pick you up at the station.
I took a seat, pretending not to listen. There were a couple of framed pictures on his desk, family photos by the look of it. One showed him together with a happy-looking woman and a slightly chubby girl. It was a holiday photo somewhere by the sea. The woman was pretty with big sunglasses and a white canvas hat. I thought about what Gemma had told me about his divorce. Were they still getting on well, I wondered. The photo made me sad. It reminded me of Jeremy again, of the holiday in Rome we'd had together. Dr. Turner ended his call and sat down at his desk.
Sorry for making you wait. How is college treating you?
He picked up a paper.
Let me give you that rehearsal schedule first.
I took a deep breath. Maybe it would be better to ask someone else.
But I just heard you practicing it.
He gave me a vaguely puzzled look, and I felt the same embarrassment.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.